Wise Financial Fitness is made possible by our members.
And bring that back to a point that Jeff mentioned early on, the E-Myth, and the E-Myth Revisited, and I think they've got a couple other, bunch of other books out, are wonderful books in talking about that, how you take a small business and standardize some of these operating procedures, and you try to treat your business like, in essence, a McDonald's. That's one of the examples that they utilize, that, you know, everything's done in the same way, in a similar fashion, because those standard operating procedures are critical. When I went into business, one of the fellows I was working with at the time, he said, George, he said, you can probably think of 8 different ways of solving every single problem, and they're all valid. They'll all work equally as well. You can't ask your employees to solve everything 8 different ways. You've got to come up with a standard operating procedures of how you want it done. Doesn't have to be even the best way.
It's a great way.
Yeah. Okay. This is the way it needs to be done.
And, you know, you'll hear this word scalability. If you have 8 different ways to do something, it's almost impossible to scale that because you just can't continually, repetitively, there's no quality control. You don't know things are being done a certain way. So that's one of the growing pains, too, is when you work in a business like I do, there's so much personality involved with financial advisors that we had to make sure that our team got very involved with clients. Because if the clients didn't know the team, then they said, I only can speak with Jeff, and that's the only person I can speak with. Mm. Well, how scalable is that? I'm one person. There's only so much work I can do. But if we can get the team empowered and teach them how to answer the phone, how to follow up on something, how do we answer this, how do we do that, that is what's called scalable. And a lot of people think, and you know, you deal with more startups and rapid growth, they want to scale everything to a huge level within 1 year. Remember on the video, how much money are we going to make?
Zillions.
They went past millions, okay? At the early part of my career when I was on my own, millions and zillions was in my mind. Then I started working on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. Then I started thinking about thousands. I hope we make thousands. You know, reality hits pretty quick when you don't eat a lot. You're out real late at night seeing clients. Reality is very sobering. Let's put it that way.
Okay. All
there's,
right.
There's something that you said that I really, really liked, and it's something that I also had an experience with, too, at that company that I was talking about. I used to manage staff that serviced the client in this tech marketing firm, and in that capacity, I wasn't just the lawyer because when I was first hired, it wasn't a big enough business to have a full-time lawyer. I had to learn the business of the business too, you know, and be a tech marketing consultant as well. And I was consulting IBM, their software group, and this was just at the time of the internet boom. And so my consulting practice within our business grew rather rapidly. And the question was, you know, once you have 5 people, 7 people, 10 people reporting to you, how do you manage that and how do you manage the client relationship? Right. And what I did was I cultivated my staff as centers of excellence for a particular topic or a particular task. This is my expert on trade shows. This is my expert on XYZ, okay? This is my expert on Java software.
Right.
And I called out that person's expertise to the client all the time and built them up, and that's the way you distribute, you know, that was...
So that's how you go through the scalability or one process. What were you saying, George?
Well, it also actually makes the business much stronger because it makes the customer loyal to the business, not necessarily to the person conducting business with them at that point in time. I mean, particularly in the investment business, you have people that are leaving firms and going elsewhere all the time.
Right.
An important thing to be would be if that customer keeps coming back to Jeff's business, whether it's Jeff or anybody else, whoever the investment advisor is, that now creates value for the business and is also at some point in time hopefully sellable as an asset.
So when you start thinking that way, like I do now, you start thinking about investment in a different way, equity management, my own equity management.
Right.
How am I managing the equity in this business? So if it was called Lehue Financial, I would have devalued the business by the name alone. There was a reason I didn't put my own name on it, because George Powers or Ben Wren might not want to own Lehue Financial.
Right.
But Wealth Resources Network was a broad name, a big name. We wanted to put the word network in to give the idea that we network with other professionals. We're building that brand. And that brand will have some value if people are loyal, like you said, to the staff. And I got to tell you, at this point, you know, I've had clients for 20 years now. Some of them know. They just go right past me and ask for the experts. And they say,
okay,
look, you know, I know Jeff doesn't handle this anymore.
Good, good.